Here's more local corporate stories. Market volatility delays Ovia Land's bid to go public. In a statement on Wednesday, the real estate firm said it will push back its initial public offering to the first quarter of 2024, noting that it will prepare its IPO once market conditions here and abroad stabilize. The firm had planned to sell nearly 400 million shares this month. Now, for another real estate firm, Rockwell Land Corporation, it announced plans to establish a premium beachfront in Lian, Batangas. The firm said the project is envisioned to be its first horizontal beach community in the area. It will be built on an 85-hectare beach property which has 700 meters of coastline and clear waters. And finally, San Miguel's affiliate bank, Bank of Commerce, sees a 30% growth in remittances from overseas Filipino workers in the first quarter of the year. The company attributes this to the success of its marketing campaigns and stronger linkages with remittance partners overseas. Meanwhile, transactions conducted through the MasterCard transaction services as of March surged more than 5 times against the same period last year. Bancom's Q1 profit increased to 713 million pesos, nearly doubling the figures recorded in the prior year. Philippine telco firm PTNT signs a partnership deal with Australian tech firm Netlinx to bring Starlink internet services to Filipino customers. Netlinx has a partnership with Starlink to bring the satellite technology to large-scale enterprises globally. With this partnership, it says Filipinos can purchase a Starlink kit directly from PTNT. U.S. billionaire Elon Musk's Starlink went live in the Philippines earlier this year. It uses low Earth orbit satellite broadband and is targeted for use in remote and underserved areas. A consortium of Philippine conglomerates doubles its projected cost to rehabilitate Manila's international airport. The MIAC says upgrades on the country's main gateway would now cost $3.8 billion or 210 billion pesos from the initial 100 billion it proposed in April. Of this amount, $1 billion will be used in the first 5 years, while the remaining $2.8 billion will be spent for the rest of the proposed 25-year concession. The new proposal also offers to government some $1 billion in upfront concession payment. The consortium says their pitch is seen to generate $14.6 billion to the economy through direct investments and similar impact on trade and tourism. The economic team holds back-to-back consultations with members of the Philippine Coast Guard and the Army to discuss the proposed military and uniformed personnel pension reform. Some members of the Coast Guard sought clarifications on the reforms, while others offered suggestions to further improve them. The Finance Department said the consultations yielded proposals that will be applied to the reform bill. It also allayed concerns of some members of the MUP over the proposed changes to their pension. The Philippine government is reviewing the current MUP pension system, which Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno had described as a big drain on the country's national budget. Vehicle sales in the Philippines continue its double-digit growth in May, according to data from the Chamber of Automotive Manufacturers of the Philippines. Over 38,000 new car units were sold last month. That is 44.8% higher compared with last year. CAMPI President Romel Gutierrez says the steady year-on-year growth recorded during the first 5 months of 2023 drives optimism in the local automotive industry that it will achieve its growth target of 10 to 15% this year. The Philippine Central Bank governor admits increasing the single borrower's limit, or SBL, makes lenders vulnerable. The SBL avoids an over-concentration of risks by putting a ceiling on the amount of loans, credit accommodations, and guarantees that a lender can extend to a single borrower or its related entities. The BSP earlier proposed to increase the SBL for loans meant to finance green projects by 15% in a bid to drum up bank support for sustainable initiatives.
What we want to do is mandate credit because we know it has not worked. We mandated credit for agriculture. The banks just decided to pay the penalties. We mandated credit for lending to medium and small-scale industries. The banks just decided to pay the penalties. So clearly, there must be other ways of supporting sustainable finance. One of them is lifting single borrower's limits. Of course, the main concern there is by lifting single borrower's limit, we also expose the banks to bigger risks.